Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Let's continue from where you all stopped the last day, and you will have reached to the end of page 837. It continues with 838, 838, and the topic of discussion is about the tree of Zaqum, which Allah has mentioned in the Quran. And when that ayah was revealed, as you have read, Abu Jahl started to make fun of what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was saying. And it was known among the Arabs that Zaqum referred to the dates on which butter was placed. It was a delicious thing. In fact, it was the Arabs used to eat that. It was very delicious. So he used to actually tell people, go and eat Zaqum. Little did he realize what Zaqum is about. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, and you have read also, where the reason they considered it to be something not which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was speaking about is because of the fact that Allah says that the tree of Zaqum grows in the midst of the fire of hell. Now, how can a tree really grow in fire when fire will burn a tree? Whether it's a dry tree or whether it's a green tree, the fire will burn it. So they considered it far-fetched, and they considered it totally impossible for the tree to grow in the fire of hell. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the creator of every single thing. And if Allah wishes for a tree to grow in the fire of hell, He will allow it to grow in the fire of hell. Now, we know very well that there will be angels in hell. But those angels that will be in hell, would they be punished on account of which they are in hell? Or if they are in hell, remember the fire of hell burns. And in hell, there is punishment upon punishment. So if there are angels in the fire of hell, wouldn't they be burnt up? The blazing heat and fire of hell? But and the Quran says that there will be angels in hell who will be deputed by Allah to punish the people. The answer is that no. Allah will create the angels in such a manner that their being in hell is like how others will be in paradise. That is how Allah will create them. And we see that among even the creation of Allah here. You and I as human beings, we cannot live in water, but Allah has created the fishes. They live in water, they can't come out of water. As soon as they come out from water, they will die. They can't live like you and I, and we can't live like them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever He wishes, He creates. And He will create the angels in such a manner that the fire will not cause any harm to them whatsoever. And they will do their duty in the fire of hell by obeying the commands of Allah and doing what He wants them to do. So too, The tree of Zaqum in the fire of hell, this is not something impossible. And it is really like that, that it is a tree which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has caused to grow in the fire of hell. Now, it also mentioned in the ayah that Allah made this and allowed this to happen, or He created the tree in the fire of hell as a test and a trial. Fitnatan, it is a test or a trial. And one commentary was that the word fitna referred to punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this tree that has been created in the fire of hell is a fitna. And the word fitna is used two ways in the Quran and also in the traditions. One is that it is a punishment. One is that it is a trial. Sometimes it is what? Mischief. So sometimes you look at something that is really bad and wrong, something that is happening, and you say, that is a big fitna. Meaning that that's something that's really mischief, that is wrong, that is sinful, that is real fitna. I'm not getting into that. You know, that's how we speak. So the word fitna is used in different ways. This is why in the Holy Quran, when that word was used, there some commentator says that when Allah says, we have created the tree as a fitna for the unbelievers, it means we have created the tree and its fruits as a punishment for the unbelievers. They will be punished through the tree of Zakum, which will bear its ugly fruits. And some commentators have stated, no, the context in which that ayah was revealed and the word was used means that fitna is a trial. Fitna means trial. Allah says in the Quran, certainly your wealth and your children, they are a fitna unto you. They are a fitna unto you. Some people who do not understand the difference say, oh, Allah says, my child, my children, they are fitna. Or my wife, she's a fitna. It doesn't mean that. It means that they are trials for you. Allah has given you children, Allah will try you through your children. Allah has given you family members, Allah will try you. So tests and trials will come through what Allah has given to us. So they say that, what was the trial for these people? It is that really no human being can think of a tree growing in fire. And that was the trial. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the human mind cannot understand that a tree can grow in fire, here is Allah who has revealed that yes, a tree will grow in the fire. The question is, would you believe or not? That's the trial. Would you believe in it or not? As for the believers, they say, yes, we believe. Allah said it and that's it. Allah speaks the truth. Huwa sadiq. Sadaqallahul azim. Whenever we recite an ayah of the Quran, we say sadaqallahul azim. Allah has spoken the truth. So the believers had no doubt regarding it. That Allah says the tree will grow, it will grow. It's not for us to understand how it will grow, you know, and what will be the nature of the tree. But the unbelievers now, the trial, is that this is impossible. It cannot happen. It cannot happen. So they denied it. They didn't pass that trial. They didn't pass the test. They openly denied it. That, in other words, they said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we cannot believe in this at all. That is totally impossible. So it was a trial and they failed in that test. And even more than that, they made a mockery of it. They made a mockery of it. So it states, in response to this absurd statement and foolish statement used by Abu Jahl and his companions about Zakum was not what the Quran said it was. It was the dates with the cream on it or the butter on it. Allah made it known that Zakum is not what the unbelievers think it is. No, it is not like that. Instead, it is a tree that grows from the bottom of the fire of hell. And hell is very deep. Hell is very, very deep. And it grows from the bottom of the hell and goes straight up. So it is a tree that will be very, very tall. This is not difficult for Allah, since He is the one who causes everything to grow in whatever manner He wishes. Allah wishes, subhanAllah, He can do anything He wishes. Nothing is difficult for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, to assume that a tree cannot grow in the hellfire is totally wrong. Even in this world, trees cannot grow in certain places. You know, the stone mountains, tree cannot grow on the stone mountains. You have some mountains when you travel, see the mountains, as the Quran says, red mountains, blue mountains, gray mountains. That's the color of these mountains. And it's bare rocks. You cannot see even a leaf. You cannot see the sign of greenery at all. So even in this world, there is no fire and a tree cannot grow. So that's not a dalil and an argument to say, oh, how can a tree grow in the fire of hell? Well, even in this world, the tree cannot grow at certain places. So what is so difficult, you know, to understand that Allah will cause a tree to grow wherever He wants it to grow, and He will cause it not to grow wherever He wants it not to grow. Subhanallah. And it remains like that. And that's final. And that is the beautiful thing about the iman that we Muslims have. Subhanallah, it is the greatest iman. Even though the brain cannot understand, and the heart and the mind cannot comprehend, once Allah says it is like that for us. Alhamdulillah, may Allah strengthen our iman and keep our faith like that and even strengthen it. The believer will go through many trials. And many things in the Holy Quran will reveal in order to test the believers. Will they listen? Will they believe what Allah is saying? Or they will believe what their minds tell them to do? So therefore, for them to assume that it cannot grow in the fire of hell, subhanAllah, that is totally wrong. Allah goes further to describe the tree of Az-Zaqum in verse 65, and he says, its fruits are like the heads of the shayateen. Subhanallah. Allah is describing it. Allah is telling the people on the face of the earth that there is this tree, the fruits of it you will be given as provision, the inmates of hell. So from the beginning he's telling them so that when people hear this, they will become frightened and they will begin to fear Allah. And they will do everything not to go in the fire of hell and not to eat of the zakum food. But you know, the provisions in the fire of hell, in Jannat, a man will have a choice to eat whatever he wishes. Dishes will be given to a person. A person can choose. He can eat whatever he wishes, and if something is presented to him that he does not like, he can order whatever he wants. So he will be treated like a king in paradise, and that's what paradise is like. But in the fire of hell, no choice will be given. Whatever is given, you have to eat that. So the people, subhanAllah, as the Quran is saying in these ayats and many different ayats, the people in the fire of hell will become very thirsty. Very thirsty. Obviously, there is nothing to drink there, one. And then the heat, it's another thing. And they will be crying and begging for water. And water will be given to them. Boiling water. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when they take a sip of that boiling water, the top lip will become so enlarged, it will cover the whole head. And the bottom lip will become so big that it will cover the whole chest. And they will be beaten to drink it. They will be told, drink it. And food they will want, the fruits of Zakum. Thorny fruits. Torn all over the fruits. It cannot pass through the throat going down. And the stench and the ugliness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes. That the fruits, they are like the head of the devils. You know, it's common language, and this is how the commentators have interpreted this a similarity that is drawn between the fruits and the devils. In common language, even among the Arabs, you know, when you want to talk about something monstrous and ugly and really, really looking bad that can scare the wits out of you, you say you're like a Satan or a devil. This man resembles a devil. It's just like a devil. So the word shaitan and Satan and devil is used for when you want to describe something as the most ugly thing. And that is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used it. Because the people to whom this has been revealed, and by extension all of us, they have not and we have not seen the devil. Isn't that so? So we don't know how the heads of the devils look like. So why will Allah say it resembles the head of the devils? To tell us how ugly and monstrous it's looking. We haven't seen it. The people to whom the Quran was revealed as the first addresses at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they didn't see the Satans and the devils. How would they know how ugly the heads are? But because it is the common tendency of person to always liken the most monstrous and ugly thing to devils and Satans and jinnats, this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draws that similarity. It is so ugly. They are like the heads of the devils. Here Allah mentions that the fruits of the zakum tree are ugly and hideous as the heads of the Satans. While commenting on this verse, some commentators like Az-Zujaj and Al-Farra, very great commentators of the Holy Quran and scholars of the Arabic language, they have stated that in this verse, the word shayateen, Satans and devils, refer to snakes. That is their commentary. They refer to snakes that have heads and crest on the heads. They have heads and a comb on the head, a crest. These are from among the most horrible, ugly-looking snakes. And foul snakes, they give off heavy and bad stench that are very thin in body, as it is mentioned in Tafsir al-Qurtubi. So, according to the commentary, and really there were some snakes that were called the shayateen or the devils, the Satan snakes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draws a similarity to that type of snake. This is the commentary given by these commentators. As mentioned by these commentators, it is in order to show the monstrous look and loathsome stench of the fruits of the zakum tree, Allah has likened these to the heads of snakes. Many exegetes, however, have stated that the word shayateen and satans is to be taken in its literal sense and do not refer to snakes. So we have two commentaries here. One commentary is that the word shayateen, it refers to a type of snakes. We have dealt with that. And what do the others say? No, it does not refer to snakes. It's supposed to be taken in its literal sense, that it really resembles the heads of the devils and the shayateen, the satans. In the verse, Allah has likened the fruits of Zakum tree to satans in order to indicate the extreme degree of ugliness, since satans and devils are awfully hideous in look. So that is the reason for the comparison to the heads of the shayateen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to bring before man, before us, before those who are the mukhatab, those who are addressed in the Holy Quran, the nature of the fruits of the zakum tree, how it will be. While speaking of the fruit of zakum, remember the people, the inmates in the fire of hell, they will be given the fruits of the zakum tree. The name of the tree is zakum, the fruits bearing from it, it will be given as provisions to the inmates of hell. So while speaking about the fruit, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said, if a drop of zakum is caused to drip on the earth, it is sufficient to turn all the foods of the worldly people distasteful. Subhanallah. If a drop, just one drop of the zakum is caused to drip on the earth, it is sufficient to turn all the foods of the worldly people distasteful. It will spoil every type of food on the face of the earth. The Prophet then said, imagine the condition of the person whose diet it will be. Imagine the condition of the person who will have to eat this fruit for his provision. When one drop of it can cause such a thing to happen, just imagine what it will be like for the people in the fire of hell. Hadith recorded by Imam Tirmizi and Ibn Hibban. Surah Saaffaat continues in verse 66 and states, the verse, it states, truly they will eat thereof and fill their bellies therewith. Subhanallah. Now, if something is so bad tasting, the stench is so much, and just imagine what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, can anybody eat one morsel phallus for filling the stomach? No. Nobody can take at least one morsel phallus for filling the stomach. And Allah says they will fill their stomach with it. They will eat until their bellies are filled. Again, they wouldn't want to do it, but the reason they will do it is because of the fact that the angels will be flogging them and beating them to eat it, and that will be a means of punishment also. The verse explains that zakum will be the food of the people of hell. So this zakum tree that has been spoken about so much, subhanallah, the Quran says this is the provision. This is their provision. This is their meals and their fruits and everything. And they will be made to eat it as their provision on account of their severe hunger. They will have no choice except to eat this fruit, which they will be given and will consume it until their stomachs are filled. So they wouldn't have any choice in the matter. They would have to eat it, subhanallah. And Allah further describes the drink, that is about the food. They will be hungry, they will be given zakum, now they will be thirsty. What they will be given, look at the beauty of the ayah. Allah says, then on top of that, as if that is not sufficient for them. It doesn't end there with the zakum. And they will say, oh, we are fed up, we cannot take anything more. Allah says, on top of that, they will be given boiling water to drink. so that it becomes a mixture in their stomach. So they have eaten the fruit. On top of it is the boiling water going down into the stomach, and both will mix up in their bellies. Here it is mentioned that after filling their stomachs with zakum, they will be given hot boiling water to drink in order to quench their thirst. In another verse, subhanallah, what will that boiling water do? In another verse, it is stated that when the people of hell will drink the boiling water, it will cut up their bowels into pieces. Just imagine if you were to drink boiling water, what it can do to you. And we are talking about the fire of hell, where it will be more boiling than what it is on the face of the earth. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, all the fire on the face of the earth put together, the fire, any fire you can think, and all put together, from the furnace, from melting lead, from melting iron, the fire that will come up before a volcanic eruption, all the fire put together will be, it's actually 1/70th part of the fire of hell. So in the hadith, he says, the fire in hell are 69 times more than the fire of this world. And the fire of this world, we are talking about the heat of the sun also. Because the sun also is a gaseous chamber giving out that heat. It's like fire, a ball of fire. So hot that we are so many miles away, thousands, millions and billions, in fact trillions of miles away. Yet it's so hot. And it's only one part of 70 parts of the fire in hell. Subhanallah. We must really make dua to Allah, for Allah to protect us from that fire of hell. Because if we can't take it here, how can we really take anything whatsoever over there in the fire of hell? So it will cut their bellies. It will cut their intestines and their stomachs, their bowels into pieces. About this, the Quran says, are these like those who shall dwell forever in the fire and be given to drink boiling water so that it cuts up their bowels to pieces? As is mentioned in Surah Muhammad. Surah Saaffaat goes further in verse 68 and states, then thereafter, meaning what? After they have taken their meals, the zakum fruits, and after they have taken their drink, the hot boiling water, after that, they are returned to the flaming fire of hell. It doesn't end there. Subhanallah. You know, in this world, a person will build himself up, build that courage in himself to meet something that he's hearing about. But when he gets it into it, he says it will finish. It will soon finish. It will come to an end. If it's a difficulty, if it is some harshness, some surgery, something, you know, if you are suffering, family members will say, don't worry, inshallah, Allah will take it away. Just a few days again or a few moments again and it will be done away with. But there is no doneing away in the fire of hell. There is no ending. Allah says, after all of that, they are being brought to what? The fire of hell. So some commentators have stated, that the fire of hell is not just one place, unlike a prison and a cell. It's huge and massive. And many different types of punishment will be given to the people. The angels will tie them with chains, will tie their feet, will shackle their hands close to their neck, and will pull them at this place to face the punishment. After that is finished, they will carry them to another place to face another punishment. After that, they will carry them to another place. And after all this will take place, the rounds will be made at the end of it. When they would have thought, or they are thinking that, okay, our day's work have come to an end. What does the Quran say? Then their return is back to the flaming fire. It's not a day's work finish. It's coming back again. You're going to be there, and then it will start again and again. So Allah says, then thereafter, verily their return is to the flaming fire of hell. The verse explains that after eating the zakum and drinking the boiling water, they shall be returned to the flaming fire of hell. While explaining the above, the great exegete Abu Hayyan, in his famous commentary Al-Bahrul Muhit, states, they shall be taken from their places in hell and be brought to eat the zakum and drink the boiling water. After this, they will be taken back to their places in hell. What does it mean? It means that they will be in the abode of the fire of hell. And then from there, they will be taken for their meals. They will be taken for their zakum, and they will be taken for their drink. And when they are finished, they will be brought back again. Some exegetes have stated that the verse indicates to the fact that at the time of eating the zakum fruit and drinking the boiling water, they, the people of hell, will be in severe punishment. They will be in severe punishment, but will not be in the hellfire as yet. It is after this they will be carried to the fire of hell. So this is another commentary. So while making their way, in other words, the commentators have stated, while making their way to the fire of hell, they will be stopped at a place to actually get the zakum fruit to eat and the boiling water. And after that is done, they will be carried. Some commentators have also mentioned that the people of hell will be moved to different places in hell in order to be chastised with varying punishments. And this is what the Holy Quran says in Surah Ar-Rahman, يَتُوفُونَ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَ حَمِيمٍ آن فَبِأَيَّ آلَىٰ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. They will be roaming around, moving around, making rounds in the fire of hell, here and there and there and here. That is how they will be. That Allah says, this is the hell which the unbelievers denied. They will go between it, roaming around, and the fierce boiling water. This is how it will be in the fire of hell for the people who are in the fire of hell from the inmates, as mentioned in Hafiz ibn Kathir's Tafseer. Surah Saaffaat continues in verses 69 and 70, and state, verily they found their fathers on the wrong path, so they too made haste to follow in their footsteps. Beautiful sequence of the verses. Allah mentions in the very beginning, you know, if we can remember how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the people in Jannah, the provisions in Jannah. And immediately after, Allah says, but the people in hell will not be like that. And then Allah went on to describe their states until now, this moment. The punishments they will get in the fire of hell. And you know, remember those verses when they are taken and they will be stopped at a certain place. And Allah says their account has to be taken as yet until this part here where they would have eaten the zakum and they would have taken the boiling water. And now they are taken back to the fire of hell. That's their abode. So the question is, where did they go wrong? That's the question. Where did they really go wrong? Didn't they hear the scriptures being revealed to them? Wasn't there a messenger who was before them? Whether the messenger was Isa alayhi salam, or Musa alayhi salam, or Ibrahim alayhi salam, or Noah alayhi salam, or at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Arabs, the likes of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab, they never used to hear the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What really happened that they will be in such terrible punishment? Allah gives the reason. Why? Because they found their fathers on the wrong path and they decided to follow them without trying to figure out whether it's wrong or right. And this is what is referred to following the forefathers in wrongdoings. The act of following is not bad, but following what and following who? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself says in the Quran, as-sabiquna as-sabiquna, that the forerunners, those people who accepted Islam first. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about those from among the muhajirun and the ansar. Those were the forerunners. Those were the first to accept Islam. The Muhajir from Makkah and the Ansar from Medina. Allah is praising them. And Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ تَبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ And those who followed them in goodness. And those who followed them in goodness, then Allah says, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْ Allah is pleased with all of them and they are pleased with Allah. So the Sahabas followed the Prophet, the Tabi'een followed the Sahabas, and every other generation, they continue to follow the good ones before them until it is our generation and we follow those pious ones from before us. So following in goodness is good. Following good people, it is good. But following bad people is bad. Following ignorance and following dhalalat and misguidance. This is why Allah says, it's not that they found their fathers and they followed them, but they found their fathers on wrong, on misguidance. They found them on shirk. They found them on kufr. And yet they followed them. They didn't ask. They didn't find out whether they were right or wrong. And against what their fathers and forefathers did, it is the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it is not that they only had one thing before them, the path of their forefathers, and they will say to themselves, we didn't know anything else except that. But here is another message, the message of truth. So they were in a position to compare. Is what Muhammad saying, is it the right thing? Or what these people are saying, is it the right thing? So they could have compared. You know, there are people who have lived in the past, such people to whom no prophet came. Such people who didn't know about any religion. Allah will excuse them because no message came to them. But people who live in a situation, they were born to others and the only thing they knew was to follow what they got. No prophet, no preacher, no teacher. Allah knows best. Allah will excuse people. Because Allah will not take a person and hold a person responsible for something he did not do and when he did not have the chance to do that which was better. Allah will not take a person to task for that. So there is a point of aqidah of the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah which speaks about people who have died in the period of fatra, not fitra, fatra. Fatra means the period after Isa alayhi salam until Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Like the Arabs. Remember, the Israelite prophets never went to the Middle East, to ancient Arabia. The Middle East prophets never visited the lands of Hijaz and Makkah and Medina. So from the time of Ismail alayhi salam, these people were left on their own. These people were left on their own. When in Misr and all these different places in Jerusalem and Nazareth and all these places, you had prophets coming one after the other. The people continued to hear. These people in this corner of the world, they had no access to the prophets nor of scriptures. So the people who lived closer to the time of Ismail alayhi salam had the teachings of Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam, but then soon it faded away. And as the time span from them, it continued to go further and further away, that's time, then the consciousness started to grow dim and also the teachings reached to such a state that it became totally lost. So there were people who did not believe in Allah, in God Almighty, in one God, but at the same time, they did not commit shirk. Because the sense they had told them, I can't worship an image. I can't worship the sun. I can't worship the moon. But yet, nobody was there to tell them who to worship. So you understand the situation. Your sense is telling you, I can't worship this man. How can I worship this man? I can't worship this tree or the water. I can't worship the mountain, but yes, I can, but who should I? What name should I call? So this is why there is a point that the people of that fatra, you know, between the time of two prophets, where the people were totally, you know, lost in the sense that there was nothing to hold on to, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will excuse people, you know, who died in a state like that and they didn't know better or they didn't do that which was the best. But these people now, they were in a position where they could actually compare. They are seeing the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They are hearing the powerful verses of the Quran, which they themselves said, this cannot be the speech of a human being. They accepted that. They acknowledged that. They said this, what Muhammad is reciting cannot be words of a human being. It has to be words of, and whatever miracles they wanted, it occurred. They tried their best to end the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They never became successful. But with all of that, you are hearing again and again, there is only one God. Worship that one God. But you decide to stick upon the path of your forefathers because of your connection, because of the family trend, because of the family religion. You know, exactly as what Abu Talib said on his dying bed, the people said to him, are you going to leave the religion of your fathers for the religion of your nephew? Are you scared of your nephew? This is what they were telling him. And the Prophet was saying, oh, my uncle, say this kalima, I will intercede to Allah for you. And Abu, the others who were there, the unbelievers, he was saying, why are you listening to your nephew? Why will you leave the religion of your forefathers? And he says, the last words, the words that came out from his tongue was, ala millati abi, I die on the religion of my father. And he breathed his last. So he was not a believer. He didn't die as a believer. Some of the Shiites believe that he died as a believer and he recited the kalima. But all the authentic narrations coming from Hafiz ibn Kathir and many other commentators, especially the scholars of history, Islamic history, they have stated that this was the very last words of Abu Talib. Ala millati abi, upon I die upon the path of my forefathers and my father. So anyhow, back to the topic of discussion here. Allah is speaking about their downfall, what really happened to them. They are living at a time of a prophet. They are seeing this prophet. They are hearing the words being revealed, but yet they didn't pay heed because they decided to hold on to the wrong path of their forefathers. And not only that, but they made haste to follow. They were quick in following the footsteps. They were quick in doing the things they learned. They will do it without even thinking anything. They will be told, do not do this and do not do that. They will show that they can do it and they made haste in doing it. So they too made haste to follow in their footsteps. Yeah, Allah mentions the reason for the misguidance of the unbelievers and states that they found their fathers on the wrong path and they simply followed them. That was it. What it's telling us is that we have to be careful and we have to think also and we have to measure, we have to look, we have to compare before we end up in a situation that we are simply following a person and he is doing something wrong and we follow him in his wrongdoing. They did not look to see what was wrong or right. This didn't bother them. You know, they did not take the time to say, is this right or this is wrong? They will just turn a blind eye to it. Turn a blind eye to it and say, our fathers used to do it. And you know, subhanAllah, it is strange to know that Muslims develop that habit also. Muslims develop that habit. That if you are preaching to them and explaining something to them, they do not want to know what is right or what is wrong. You see, you know what? My father used to do it, and my uncle used to do it, my grandfather used to do it, so I am doing the same thing. And this is the pattern of these people. So Allah has given us a brain to think, and He implores us in the Quran when He says, "Afala ta'qilun," don't you have a brain? Can you reason? Can you not think for yourself? You know, so this attitude also is not belonging to Islam of just simply following, saying, okay, well, they did it, I'm going to do it. Think also. If you think and you realize that, yes, what they did is right, subhanAllah, so you are doing the right thing because you are convinced that that's the right. once obviously you have the sufficient guidelines to tell you what is right. So they did not look to see what was right or wrong and what was good or bad. Instead, they wholeheartedly adopted the beliefs and practices of their fathers and ancestors and went on the same misguided path. So, their fathers were misguided. They didn't decide to move away from that. They just wanted to follow. So they ended up in the same place and in the same situation. Allah goes further in verse 71 and states, "And indeed most of the men of old went astray before them." Subhanallah. Allah says not only these people have gone astray, but many of the people in the beginning, for the same reason they went astray. For the very same reason. They just want to follow, you know, and they do not want to listen. They do not want to take time and see what is right or what is wrong. What I am doing, is it right or wrong? When they are seeing so many signs that are coming before them. So Allah says, "And indeed most of the men of old went astray before them." Here Allah mentions that in the past, many people also went astray. They did not choose that which was right, nor did they follow the teachings which came to them through the prophets. They preferred to stay on their incorrect ways and thus remain misguided. They remain misguided. And we also must be very, very careful when it comes to a point like that, to ensure that what we do is right. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never gave us a religion and a way that is wrong. It is the right thing. So we always have to compare our actions to the guidance which Allah has given. The Holy Quran, the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the explanations of these two primary sources that came from the Sahabas and every other generation. How did they understand it? What did they do? How did they act? How did they practice? And that's the yardstick we can use to see and to know our practices, whether they are right or they are wrong. Just to close our eyes and say, okay, so-and-so is doing it, I will do it also. No. Because our deed is to follow the guidance Allah has given. Not to follow an individual. We have to get that straight. So on the day of judgment, that will not be an excuse. Allah says, but I told you, you have to follow this. You followed something else. So that is something we have to pay particular attention to. In verse 71, Surah Saaffaat goes further and states, "And indeed most of the men of old went astray before them," about those people, and it continues in 72, "And indeed we sent among them mourners." Subhanallah. So many of the people in the past went astray. And how does verse 72 connect it? In this way, by where Allah says, "Although we sent many mourners to them." Subhanallah. So these people here, first of all, there are two categories of people being spoken about. One is that these people here who lived at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they went astray because they decided to follow their forefathers in wrongdoing and were not bothered about the teachings that came from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's one category of people. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, let's leave them aside. Many of the people in the past also went astray, although we sent many warners to them. So it is not that they went astray because there was the absence of any warner, any teacher, any messenger, any guide, or any prophet. Allah says, many were the warners we sent to them, one after the other. At one particular time, sometimes two and three messengers were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they didn't pay heed. They did not pay heed at all. They kept on their wrong path, their misguided path, held on to it firmly, and did not look towards the teachings and the message given to them by the prophets of Allah. Allah says, "And indeed we sent among them warners, messengers." Here it is mentioned that Allah sent many prophets to the past nations. They were not left alone. They were not left alone without a guide. They, the prophets, invited the people to the truth and warned them of Allah's punishment. But the people turned away in rejection and stayed upon their misguided path. As for others, the believers, they accepted the teachings of the prophets and became sincere believers in Allah and were thus guided by Allah. So those who accepted the prophets, subhanallah, Allah blessed them with guidance, goodness in this world and the hereafter. And those who did not believe, they remained as misguided people on the face of the earth, and hence they would suffer the consequences of their actions in the hereafter. So while indicating to the end result of each of these groups, what was the ultimate? What is the ultimate? What was the end result? In this world, some people believe and some people do not believe. As I mentioned before, some classes ago, to the onlooker, both look same. They look the same. They are human beings. They are enjoying life. Some people believe and others do not believe. When they die, what will happen? Allah says, then see what was the end of those who were warned, but he did not. What was the end result? What happened to those who disbelieved? What happened to those who did not listen? What happened to the people, unbelievers at the time of Nuh alayhi salam? What happened to the Ad and the Thamud? What happened to the people at the time of Pharaoh? Allah says, look and see what happened to them. Look. See what is the end result of those people who choose to remain on the path of misguidance. See the end result of those people who turned away from the message of the prophets of Allah. Allah says, then see what was the end. That itself is a threat. Allah says, you want to know what can happen to you? Look at what happened. What was the end? What happened to them? Right on the face of the earth, they were destroyed. Who were not destroyed except the chosen slaves of Allah, subhanallah. Allah protected them. Allah gave them aman. Allah blessed them with security. So while the punishment came to everybody, Allah protected his believers. Lut alayhi salam, 5 cities were destroyed at one time. Utter destruction. 5 cities carried up to the sama ad-dunya, the sky of the earth, and turned upside down and left alone to fall. The few believers with Lut alayhi salam were saved and protected. Subhanallah. At the time of Saleh alayhi salam, at the time of Hud alayhi salam, massive destruction came. Massive destruction. They were destroyed. But who was saved? The Prophet and his few believers. Nuh alayhi salam, the incident will come. 950 years of preaching and 80 believers. Subhanallah. When Allah decided to destroy, he destroyed everyone. Nuh alayhi salam and the believers were saved. So on one hand, there is total destruction to some. And on the other hand, there is rescue and safety and protection given to some. Who were those who were protected? And who were those who were punished? Allah says, see the end result and you will know for yourself. He says, the chosen slaves of Allah will always be protected by Allah. Will always be. There is no doubt about that. The chosen slaves of Allah, sincere believers, true Muslims, will always be protected by Allah in every situation. As for those who did not heed the warning, they were punished by Allah in this world and will suffer a terrible torment in the hereafter. As for those who accepted the teachings and followed the path of guidance, they were saved from the punishment in this world and that of the next. About them, Allah said, except the chosen slaves of Allah. It means that the believers who were chosen by Allah and were steadfast in his obedience were saved from the punishment of Allah. They were not punished at all in this world, and they will not be punished in the hereafter. Having mentioned previously that many people in the past were misguided and they turned away from the path of success and salvation, Allah goes further in the forthcoming verses to highlight some of these prophets who came to their people as warners and the manner in which the people became misguided. Subhanallah, it's a beautiful sequence. So Allah said in the verses just before that many people went astray because they chose the path of misguidance, although we sent many warners to them. So Allah now goes in a little bit more detail. Who were those people? What was their punishment? who were some of the warners that came to them. And it is mentioned here from among these prophets, Allah mentions Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. And he states, and indeed, Nuh invoked us. Yani, Nuh called on us. He made dua to us. He supplicated to us. What does Allah say afterwards? And we are the best of those who answer. Meaning that we are the best who will answer the du'as of a person, and we answered the du'a of Nuh alayhi salam. Subhanallah. Two important things. One, that the Nabi of Allah called on Allah, supplicated and made du'a to Allah. And as a believer, as a Nabi, Allah, who is the best of those who will answer the du'as, accepted the du'as, answered the du'as. The above verse indicates to the mission of Nuh alayhi salam. This much is sufficient here to talk about the history of Nuh alayhi salam, with a few verses coming afterwards. So Allah does not mention about the beginning, who was the nation of Nuh alayhi salam, and what he came and he taught the people, as is mentioned in Surah Nuh itself. But the maqsad here is to show that the people were warned and they did not pay any attention. So the people were warned until they made fun and mockery of Nuh alayhi salam. And when they actually had crossed all limits in their disrespect towards Nuh alayhi salam, Nuh called on Allah. He says, Rabbi anni maghlumun fantasir. Maghlubun anni maghlubun fantasir. Oh my Lord, I have been overpowered now. You help me. I can't go anymore. They have crossed all the limits. So he was sent with the message of Tawheed, monotheism to his people, but they denied him and rejected his message. Not many of his people believed in him, although he lived amongst them for a long period of 950 years. Whenever he preached to them, their dislike for him increased. That's what the Quran said. They hated him more and more. The more he preached, the more they hated him. And they continued to ridicule him, mocking him every time he preached to them. When he saw that no other person was willing to accept his message besides those who already believed, and that they had reached the extreme limit of mocking him and his message, he called out to Allah saying, Oh my Lord, I have been overcome, so help me now. How did Nuh alayhi salam know? How did he know that nobody else will accept his faith? Allah revealed to him. Allah said, Oh Nuh, besides those who have already accepted you, nobody else will accept. Nuh alayhi salam says, Oh Allah, if that's the case, it's time to destroy those people now. And do not leave a single household of the unbelievers remaining. Because if you leave them, they will start kufr and shirk again. And this is when he called on Allah. And Allah responded his call and sent the azab to the people. So we stop there and we'll close off with this term.
بتقسى كل يوم على بعضها ليه دنيا الناس بتنسى